I speak to you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Favorite and favoritism. Favorite and favoritism. We all have favorites. We all engage in favoritism. We have favorite books, favorite foods, favorite drinks, favorite colors and favorite clothes, favorite friends and favorite family members. We have favorite TV shows and favorite movies and favorite music. We have favorite places to visit and favorite toys with which we love to play. We all have our favorites. We all engage in favoritism. And we also have our favorites when it comes to the church, whether it is our favorite pew, and no one better sit in the seat that we love to sit in. Or we may have our favorite hymn, and we wish we could sing it every Sunday, even though no one else likes it. We have our favorite person with whom to speak after the service, who may look and think and act, and they're like us. We also have our favorite biblical passages, and may even have our favorite lay persons who participate in the service. We have our favorite. We engage in favoritism. And it is this theme of favoritism that the second reading from James's letter addresses today. It is apparent that the early church had just as much problems as we do when it comes to showing favoritism, particularly when it comes to ignoring the poor while favoring the rich. And James spoke about it. And he spoke about it back then, and we're still speaking about it now after many hundreds of years, even a couple thousand years. And in this passage, James begins by challenging the authenticity of the faith of the people back then and their relationship with Christ. And he says, "My brothers and sisters, do you, with your acts of favoritism, really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ?" In other words, can you really call yourselves Christians if you show favoritism to one person and scorn or despise another? Are you genuinely following Jesus when you do this? There is no doubt that James is telling us that part of demonstrating our faith in Christ is by the way we treat others. Our being not impartial to others, our not being unfair to others, our not favoring one person over another, is what is expected of us as God's children, as God's people, as God's followers. And since James uses the word assembly to emphasize what we call the congregation or the church, as Christians we are expected not to show favoritism toward other Christians as well. But James even delves further into explaining what it means by giving a very graphic example. And this is where we probably will now start twisting in our seats and twitching and feeling uncomfortable. And he gives us this scenario, this example. If a wealthy or well-to-do individual wearing really nice clothes, if it's a woman, she's wearing a beautiful dress. If it's a man, he's wearing the finest suit and tying shoes and throwing a few colorful socks for good measure. And if the person was wearing nice jewelry, then say gold rings. But in our day, it is probably what? Huh? Diamonds. Oh, yeah, I really want diamonds these days. Gold is, we want diamonds. And if such an individual was to walk into our congregation, how would we respond to them? How would we respond to them? On the other hand, if a poor person came into the church or church building at the same time as the wealthy person, and that individual was wearing ragged, dirty clothes, sneakers that were once white but are now black and tattered, and no doubt he or she is having an aroma like that, like they haven't had a shower in weeks, how would we respond to that individual? How would we? And James says, we are going to treat the two individuals differently, but that shouldn't be the case. James tells us that we are going to treat the two individuals differently, but that shouldn't be the case. We are going to fuss over one and shun the other, to take notice of one and ignore the other. We are going to give one the royal treatment, and the other we're going to treat as a nobody. And after the service, we would probably want to show one the church campus, while the other person, we simply wish they would just go away. We will seek to impress one and not the other. We will treat the person who looks wealthy different to the one who doesn't. And we do this not only as a church, we do this all the time in our lives. We treat people like this wherever we go and with whomever we encounter. And our treatment of them is often based on our assumptions of them. From the time we see these two persons, we make assumptions based on their appearance, even if we do not vocally say it. And James is not saying that the wealthy person or people in general cannot dress the way they prefer, or that they have to look like a poor person. James is not saying that at all. That is not James's concern. James's concern is with the treatment we as Christians give to people in general, but particularly to those who are poor. And James chided the congregation for making distinctions between the rich and the poor, for choosing one over the other. He said, listen, my beloved brothers and sisters, has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom of God that he has promised to those who love him? And then he continues, but you have dishonored the poor. But you have dishonored the poor. And James tells us that we shouldn't be making any differences. We shouldn't be comparing them and making distinctions between the rich and the poor, or between any person for that matter. We shouldn't be favoring one person over another. And then James goes on to state that we do not fulfill God's law of loving your neighbor when we love certain neighbors and we shun others. And according to him, we sin in the eyes of God when we show partiality and favoritism. For when we start showing partiality and favoritism to one person or another, or when we show partiality and favoritism within our faith community, or partiality and favoritism among our families and in our homes, or when we show partiality and favoritism among our groups and our organizations, we create division when we do these things. We create division when we do these things. engaging in favoritism tears families apart. It tears organizations apart. It tears homes and churches apart. And please don't slap me when I go out when I say this, because I may offend some of you, and that's not my intention. But how many parents have a favorite child among their children, and it's quite obvious to the other children? How do you think the other children feel or felt? How do you think they feel about the favorite child? And if you have difficulty imagining what that looks like, just read the story of Isaac and Rebekah and their sons Jacob and Esau. Or read the story of Jacob and Joseph and his brothers. And you will see that division sets in and families are torn apart. And it's the same in the church family. Division sets in and the family is torn apart. And maybe you're saying, that's easier said than done, Father. It takes a special person to be able to do that. And God says to you and me that we are called to be special people if we are His followers and His children. As I always say, put yourself in the position of the one who is not favored, or the one who is shunned and treated with disdain, and tell me if you would like that kind of treatment given to you. And if you don't, why then would we risk to do it to others? And as it pertains to favoring the rich over the poor, we go against everything Jesus taught. Throughout the scriptures, God has been concerned for and cares about the poor and the marginalized and the oppressed. And we saw it again. We heard it this morning in the first reading from the book of Proverbs. You know, can you really imagine if we had to remove all the verses from the Bible that speaks about the poor, what the Bible would look like? Can you imagine that? Or what we would be left with? And don't mention the Gospels at all. There would be no Christmas story of Jesus' birth, and therefore there would be no Christmas. And I don't even have to go any further, because you already don't want to not have Christmas, do you? Can you imagine if we took that out of the Bible? The Christmas story? God has always cared about the poor. His Son was born into poor means. Not that God doesn't care for the rich or the middle class. Of course He does. He cares for everyone. But He knows that the poor has been and continues to be frowned upon and treated with disdain. No one likes honoring or respecting the poor. And God knows if He doesn't care for the poor, who will? Because normally we don't care for the poor. He does. Everyone appears to be only interested in the rich or even being rich. And this is why James warns us, as he warned the people of the early church who were probably poor themselves, instead of following the world's value system, which often makes the rich richer and the poor poor, James takes us back to the book of Leviticus. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. And this is the central point of Jesus' teaching. Love God first and love your neighbor as yourself. These are the two great commandments. It is on these two commandments that our lives and our being are based. And if we are going to love our neighbors, we cannot ignore them. We cannot overlook them or look right through them. We need to look at them. Get to know them by spending time with them. So, my friends, let us not be judgmental of others. And judgmental doesn't mean that we see persons as being inferior to us. We can see them as being superior to us as well and still be judgmental. But regardless, when we become judgmental, we compare ourselves to others. And instead of following Jesus' teaching, we use the world's values of turning to our own egos when interacting with them, and it affects the way we treat others. James calls us to demonstrate God's favor, not our own favoritism, when we meet others. For it builds our faith into something that is alive and a faith that works. It allows us to do things for others, not just to speak or to talk with them and do nothing. For as he says, what good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? For faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. As our love for God grows, my friends, and matures into a deeper, fuller love, and as our faith becomes stronger and more alive, we will realize that having favorites and engaging in favoritism is not what God intended for us to be doing. God's intention is to pour his favor on us so that we can share it with others no matter who we are. The rich and the poor, the young and the old, the black and the white, the brown and the yellow, the gay or the straight, it doesn't matter. God has no favorites, for we are all God's children.